Sorry.
Still going on.
All right, I'm trying to decide.
Oh, no problem.
Can I do a running note?
Access of the library.
I'm going to start just. I think we're going to get started. It's a couple minutes after 9. I'm here in McKinney. That's right on my 9th right. From the SBDC. And as you all know, we've got the cybersecurity program today. And I'm going to start with a little story that happened right out of the coffee thing today. I thought that would be a perfect thing to start out with. I met Sue at the tea over there in the thing. And I was telling her a story that I heard at one of our sessions at the National Conference. And I was telling her that there was a partnership, two guys, and actually guitar case business. They make high-end guitar cases for the musicians. I think they might have been in Tennessee, located in Tennessee, and I think they were bringing in something like $30,000 a month, $40,000, something like that, and they noted, this is a story that one of the speakers said, they noticed, like, I believe it was like last year, a year ago, this summer, around July and August, that they weren't getting the sales that they always got before, and they began digging a little, and sure enough, somehow they found out that their website had been hijacked and sold, actually, to a jewelry company in China. And they weren't getting, and most of their business was internet-based, and they weren't getting any sales, you know, for July, and it took them a little while to figure all of this out. And at the end, you know, they had to redesign their website, and Sue said to me, well, what did they do to prevent cybersecurity attacks in the future? I said, gee, I don't know. And she said, well, that's why I came to find out. I said, but I'm not the main speaker. You know, I'm not the expert at it. I just am preaching the need for it all. And hopefully today, and I'm also talking to our speakers, let's get the answer to Sue, like what they probably did in that case, or what somebody could do in that case when they redesign their system to make sure some attacker can't come in and steal their, you know, their website and da 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 da. But you know, there. And another interesting tip I learned there is because of the kind of things that happened that I just mentioned and other things, and you know, you hear stories about. actually, this happened to an elderly friend of mine, where her computer was getting the message, "I'm Microsoft," and all of that. It's funny. This is just another little quick funny story. So we're on the way back from we had gone out, and she was saying, you know, I was so mad yesterday. I had to call that credit company 3 times to tell them that these guys are not fraudulent and to let them charge me $400 so that my computer is fixed. And I said, Dorothy, it sounds like this is weird to me. And I said, this sounds like fraud to me. Are you kidding me? You know? And sure enough, that was as well. You know, people can actually take over a computer and demand ransom. And this is happening more and more and more. So when you add up all kinds of things like this, the average cost to a small business of a cyber attack is $38,000. That's what they found lately. So I think you're smart to be here. We've got a great team of speakers. Peter Mullen from Wilke & Associates is going to introduce them and be the moderator today. But I just want to thank our promotional partners for this program. North Allegheny Regional Chamber of Commerce, Butler Chamber of Commerce, Butler County CDC. By the way, those chambers are our partners in many, many programs, not just this one. Chatham's Woman Business Center, and Ian Flinchlick is right there. Wilke & Associates, SMC, where we're in their nice conference room right now. And of course, our speakers from Bit by Bit Internet Security and Perfection Services, and Peter will be introducing them right now. So let's get started. Let's learn a whole lot.
Thank you.
All right, I'm introducing, we have three speakers today, and again, welcome to come to this presentation of this pretty pertinent subject these days. I think I would be surprised if anybody here who hasn't gone through or knows somebody who hasn't gone through some issue lately with some cybersecurity issues, should I say. First speaker is Mr. Albert Whale. He's one of the founders of IT Security, and his partner Hugh Haggerty is in the back there also. Mr. Whale has an extensive background in protecting everything from international corporations to small and mid-sized companies. His background extends from application development and security, training, and enterprise solutions as well. And recently he has become the new sector chief of Pittsburgh InfraGuard Member Alliance, and I'll let him explain what that is when he comes up here. The second speaker is Mr. Ken Doerbecker. Ken is a 51-year veteran of the IT industry, and he started out as a field engineer with IBM at the age of 17. He retired from his 28-year career as the branch office manager in Pittsburgh, and then he started Perfection Services, Inc., and for the past 24 years, PSI, as it's known, has been providing high-quality, professional-level, leading-edge, affordable IT support to the small and medium-sized business community centered in Pittsburgh. PSI was rated number one small business managed service provider last year. And again, as we all know, Pittsburgh is a relatively small community. When I was looking up Ken's bio last night, I realized he's our office just moved last year, about a year ago, and now he's in our old office. And then the next final speaker is Brett Creasy. Brett is a certified computer examiner, and he leads the computer forensic examiners and technicians at Bit by Bit, which is located downtown, in the preservation and analysis of electronic evidence. He regularly provides expert testimony in state and federal court on a variety of digital forensic matters, including the theft of trade secrets and confidential information. Brett has conducted hundreds of examinations on a variety of systems, including laptops, desktop servers, cell phones, external devices, and USB hard drives and optical media. And again, another small Pittsburgh thing is Brett works at a firm where my daughter used to work. So I don't want to give Brett. So the other person I don't know any further is Albert, but I'll introduce him now. So you're up. Thank you.
Hey, Albert, can I just say one quick thing first? What I just handed out, actually what sparked this whole seminar is we've got a special program funded by SBA to begin to inform small businesses about cybersecurity. And this is a survey, which we'd really love it if you choose to fill it out. And then you'd also have to fill out a request for consulting, because I have to add it into the database. But it's a very good learning experience as you fill out the survey. So maybe you could take a minute or two after the program today and fill this out. We would really appreciate it. But like I said, the two have to come together. Okay, thank you. Okay. And also just thanks to Karen Wygand, who is here from SBA. Karen, wait to everybody.
Hi. Hi, Karen.
Hi, Albert.
All right, let's get started. I think we're running slightly long, but we'll get this done so you can get back to your office by 11. My name is Albert Whale. I recently became the IT Technology Sector Chief for the Pittsburgh InfraGuard Member Alliance. I co-founded the FBI InfraGuard right after 9/11. So this foundation, this organization, has been teaching cybersecurity to the national critical infrastructure, and that includes most of the manufacturing facilities, the banking, the utilities, transportation, and other organizations here in Western Pennsylvania and across the country. So we share information through InfraGuard notifications that we distribute to our membership and help them become more secure. That's just another feature for the InfraGuard Member Alliance. I'm sure you get a lot of updates, and if you don't, then I can talk to you later about that. But I'm here today to talk about cybersecurity and my company, IT Security. This was at a recent conference here at CMU. I thought it was a great picture, and I didn't know if I would be here. I was actually in San Jose had an active exploit last week, but we finished the project and I returned on Monday so I could be here today. Next slide. So IT security works with organizations to work on their cybersecurity issues, whether it's proactively keeping the hackers out of your network, or reactively, when you find out that there's an exploit, what do? Well, you can wait until they're done and call somebody later on, or you can call us and we'll help you fix it right away. We want to help fix these problems so that you can be more competitive. If the hackers get your data, they're gonna take it and they're gonna sell it to somebody who's gonna stand up a different business that's being more competitive against you, because they don't have your startup costs in mind and they don't have the research going on that you invested in your organization, so they can make it cheaper, faster, quicker, and it doesn't mean that you're gonna get any of the benefits of it. So who wants my data? Well, you know, there's a big thing to be said that the hackers want it. They wanna make money on it because that's how they do it. But what about your competition? Maybe they wanna know something about your intellectual property. How did you design this new variation of steel? Or how did you make this manufacturing process more streamlined? And government-supported organizations. Those are usually foreign nationals. The biggest government or supported organization I can think of is the Chinese Blue Army. They stand up a hacker force that's dedicated 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and they work three shifts. They have different levels of attackers that are constantly scanning the internet for your vulnerabilities, and they actually are scanning your systems before you even start. And they'll use tools like Google, because everybody wants to be on Google, right? And they'll use your Google information to figure out your vulnerabilities. And why are they doing that? Because if they can get your data, which is easier to get than trying to generate new information, new clients, new whatever, then they're ahead of the curve, okay? And they've got a lower footprint at getting in. If they get your personal identification, like your social security or your health care or your banking information, they can sell that data for a lot of money. If they get your business information, they've stolen your intellectual property. You don't get it back. I like to say it's like putting the genie back in the bottle. Barbara Eden never wanted to go back in that bottle when she was in I Dream of Jeannie, remember? Next slide. So how do they do this? Well, it's been an evolving series of attacks. And it used to be, before 2000, we'd have viruses that blow up your screen and you'd see, you've been hacked, or you have this virus name, or whatever. And then they started thinking, wow, if I can explode a virus and make it manipulate through multiple systems like a worm does, maybe I don't want to tell them that they're infected, okay? And I can spread it much quicker because I don't have to display information on the screen. Oh, well, maybe I want to use a spyware tool so that I'm not active all the time and I can activate it whenever I want. Or get a rootkit so that when you reboot your machine, you have an active exploit. The evolution of cybercrime makes it possible for these actors, hackers, and threats to be active in our networks and our computers because of the technology that we employ. If you think about it, most of the technology that we have, including your smartphones, our cameras, the projector, and the computers, are all built in one place. Do you know where that is? It's China. Most of that technology has built in back doors. All the functionality of your cell phone comes without a firewall, yet it had the same computing power as our personal computers do. So when you download apps from the store to do different things, who tested it? Do you know? A lot of applications get tested the first time when it gets distributed on the store. But then Apple or Google or whoever store that you're buying it from makes changes to libraries, and then developers will modify their code and it never gets tested again. So now they can introduce new backdoors, new libraries that weren't originally deployed in the first version, and you now have an exploit on your phone, or your computer, or wherever you are. Recently, last week, as a matter of fact, the WPA2 crack exploit was announced for getting into your computer systems through Wi-Fi. They would replay the attack, get your credentials, and now Bob's your uncle, or the hackers in your house. So we have increased attack service through mobility and cloud. I know everybody thinks cloud is the place to be, but where is it? Mary, great idea. It's up there somewhere, right? I don't know where it is. And that's the point. Because when you give your data over to a cloud provider, it's not yours anymore. You can try to get it back, but it's recorded on other systems and servers. So now, instead of giving security to our environment, we're giving it away. And you might sign a service level agreement, an SLA, about, hey, we're going to have 5 nines worth of uptime and security. But as soon as they get breached, you can't get that data back, right? So you're more often better off to protect it in your own environment. We've recently made some agreements with organizations about data protection, which takes the data out of its current form. A lot of people think encryption is a great way to obfuscate or remove the sensitivity of data. But the same way that you encrypt data, the hackers are able to decrypt it. But if we chop that data up into multiple parts and then distribute it across multiple disk drives, we found that this grade of tokenization, we're going to call it micro-tokenization, makes it so that even if they stole all of the disk drives at the same time and tried to piece the data together, they'd never be able to get it back in the same format that you originated it from. That's a form of protection that we can employ fairly easily. It goes in seamlessly, and we can help you migrate to that event through two lines of code to activate the new solution, okay? That's leveraging security in an environment where you have sensitive information. What's our next slide? So how do we start all this? Well, it all starts with an assessment. So I stepped back a second ago and I was telling you that the hackers are generally trying to scan your network all the time, about 4 times a day. We're defending our servers on the internet from attacks 50,000 times a day, okay? And that's without a firewall. So our tools are able to withstand and persist these active exploits and DDoS attacks. That's a distributed denial of service from multiple points around the world, including China, Brazil, Romania, Russia, whoever the bad actors are. And some of them are here in the US as well, okay? Because just as much as you can stand up a cloud service in China, you can stand up a cloud service, oh my God, did I just say that? In the United States. And they'll take your money. And you'll go do whatever you want to go do on it because you're paying for the service, right? So you need to have that technology to know, where am I vulnerable? That's where a security assessment comes in. Normally, and I'd say normally being 5 years ago, we were recommending an annual assessment. But with the evolution of technology and the way that we're adding to our networks, we're doing patches every Tuesday for Microsoft. And if that doesn't tell you about the security there, I don't know what will, all right? But as soon as you make a change into your environment, you're supposed to do some kind of a security assessment, usually within 30 days. And most people think that has to do with the network itself, and that's fine if you're doing something at least semi-annually, if not quarterly. Remember, the attackers are using all of the tools at their resources, including Google, and a few things that you want to have review you in order to scan your environment without you knowing that they're doing it. There's lots of tools out there like Shodan that utilize resources from Google and other robots that scan the environment to come up with, where are you vulnerable? So all they need to do is query on that database, and they can find all of the routers that have default passwords because the administrator didn't configure it right. The IT department patched the WAN network into the LAN interface, and the firewall was no longer a firewall, it's a switch. Okay? All those types of activities are easily detected externally. And unless somebody outside of your organization takes a look, how will you know? That's kind of why we were on a trip to San Jose to figure out what did they not cover. We came up with about 14 pages of things that they could do in less than a week, all right? And it's not their first time, but they just haven't started yet. So the thing to do is start. Even if you make a mistake when you start doing a security activity, you can change it later on to improve it, to make it better. So originally it was annually. We're saying you should probably do it quarterly, or if you prefer, there are tools that we can deploy internally that will constantly look for modifications and actually stop a breach before it's fully executed. We can stop ransomware because we can see when an activity changes that computer to infect the boot sector and make it so that you're not going to get hacked. All right? It's just a matter of choice. Do you want to do that? Great, we have solutions that will do that now. Next slide. Hit it again. So, where can you find a security consultant? Well, in this room we have two from IT security, myself and my business partner, Hugh Haggerty. We're with the InfraGuard, so we work with security, we're vetted, all right? We work with government as well as business, and we're easy to reach. I'm sure there are other organizations that can help point you to it, like the SBA or the Duquesne University. Mary's working with Duquesne. But in this room, you have several experts from different companies, and we're here to help you. Myself, personally, I've got 30 plus years in IT, started out with application development, networking, and have worked in cyber exclusively since 9/11. Right after 9/11, I co-founded the FBI InfraGuard, and that's the organization that I'm the new sector chief from. Any questions? I think that's the end of my presentation.
I just have a quick comment.
Yes.
Albert, it's interesting. I keep hearing, I think I might have gone to a seminar one time about how the cloud is really more secure. Because you've got all of these, you know, three or four companies only, they have all these systems that are constantly monitoring your data. So the argument has been you're safer in the cloud than you are other places because you've got these very huge companies in charge of it. I guess Amazon has a cloud, other ones.
So
I don't know. What's your comment to that?
My comment is, if they were so secure, why are they having bug bounty programs to have hackers look at their environments to attack them and tell them where they're vulnerable? Google does that, and they've done it for years on their Gmail platform. But here's the problem. Gmail is hosted through a web browser, and not only are they hosting people that want to pay for the service, but they're getting it for free, but they're also getting hackers that are giving Google money for advertising their wares or whatever they want to promote through AdWords, keywords, and other organizations. All right. We've had great success with our spam zapper tool. We kept a local business that was in the news last night out of the news. They switched to a competitor product from Fortinet. Didn't do them so good. We've seen great success in filtering out the rogue emails and giving you pure email. And that's one of our successes. If we can keep email being used for what it was intended to, not an attack platform to get into your computer systems, but to do business and to congratulate people and send pictures around it and make you feel good, give you back email, then we're winning. The last thing we want to tell you to do, though, is to use an antivirus as protection because it's a reactionary tool. So if you're in a reactionary mode, that means you've already been exploited. You've had the attack already. We want to get in front of it to stop the hackers from getting inside your computers. Until you do that, things won't change. If you're going to rely on tools that are looking for how you got hacked already, like a virus scare, you're going to continue down that pathway. Yeah?
You mentioned two lines of code that are going to basically chop up all the data, in other words, that you meant.
Right. We have a...
How to prevent them from getting two other lines of code and getting into your two lines and just woo-hoo, eliminate it?
That's a good question. But the information is distributed, and you get keys that only your organization has, okay? Now, the difference is, and we have videos about how this is all done on YouTube for you, and I'd be happy to share it with you, but the tokenization key that you pass to get the data back is a variable length string, and then you mask it with 1,000 other keys that only the application knows how to get the real key from, okay? So if you're hiding data within data, it's a good approach to use because steganography is hiding data inside a picture. You're hiding data inside of data, and big banks are doing this right now. And I can't tell you the names because they don't want to be known yet about doing this, but one of them's in New York. They're a well-known bank, and can't think of their tagline. So anyway.
Any Pittsburgh banks doing it without naming names?
Not yet.
Okay.
But we're talking to them. Some of their ATMs are going to use a different portion of this technology to keep the replay attacks from happening. It's great use for SCADA equipment, PLCs. If you've got a process that demands high uptime, we have great architectural design tools and forensics review of networks to make them more secure. One of the networks that I think of all the time is the water and electric plant for the country of Aruba. If you go on vacation and you go to Aruba, which I highly recommend, their system was protected by our network design and the topology that we put together because they demand that they have power. The American people want electricity and air conditioning, and you gotta have water in order to live in a desert, right? So without those things, they couldn't have tourism in Aruba. Good questions. Anyone else? Thank you.
Said is absolutely true, and I agree 100% with it. We are a small local company, and what we do is we provide outsourced IT department services to small and medium-sized businesses. We become their IT department. So what we've done, Chris asked us that we would give you something you can take away. Well, what do I do when I go back to the office? So what we did is we took our total management, our computer management package, and pulled out of it the security stuff that we do, and put this together into a presentation for you. As I go through some of the concepts that we employ and some of the products we use, you can take notes on. Most of the products we use are available on a retail basis, or if they aren't, I have an alternative in there for you. Okay? Stuff you can take back and implement. These are the kind of things I'll be talking about. And Jim, if we can go to the next slide. The concept we employ is one of layers of protection. There is no single solution to security. Security is a very dynamic situation. It's constantly changing. Hackers are out there being very creative all the time. Employees are out there being kind of brain dead all the time. So things are constantly evolving. the products I'll tell you about today that we use right now with our customers, none of them existed 3 or 4 years ago. It's constantly changing. And even now, we have new things under evaluation to utilize on our customers' behalf. So it's just a tough thing to do. You got to know what you're doing. Failure to secure your network is catastrophic. The common statistic that goes around in the IT business is that businesses that lose their data through a hack, two-thirds of them are out of business within 6 months. And if you think that's startling, think about what would you do if you went to work tomorrow and none of the information you had stored on your computers was available anymore. The only thing you had was stuff you had written down or stuff you had in your head. Where would you be? You'd probably be out of business in 6 months. You wouldn't know who your customers were, what your invoicing was, what your projects were, any of that stuff. So it's catastrophic. You've got to do something to protect yourself. The more layers you can add, the safer you are. Are you ever 100% safe? No, you're really not. There'll always be something you did today that somebody figures out a way around tomorrow. People create security. People can breach security. It's the same minds working on it. The question is to do all you can reasonably afford to protect yourself. So the first layer of security we employ is what I call perimeter defense, stopping and balancing from even getting into your network. There's two levels of doing that. One is literally before it even reaches the outmost device you have is your router before it even gets there. Now there's a concept called DNS. I don't want to speak gibberish to you guys, but the whole internet works on a concept of domain names. That's www.mybusiness.com. But the internet doesn't know where that is, where to go to get the information about that. So it looks it up in a domain name server. Your domain names are registered in domain name servers all over the world. And next to that name is your IP address. Now, IP address is the equivalent. If you think of a phone book, your domain name is your name, or your company's name, and the IP address is your phone number. All of your devices, the routers that run the internet, can find you by your IP address. So they have to look it up somewhere. Well, there was a little company, similar to the kind of guys that Albert is, really smart guys that know how to do this stuff, called OpenDNS. And they ran DNS service, which was a service that you needed for somebody to find your domain name on the internet. And they got very big, very quick, and they do something like 15% of the domain name requests that go over the internet are run through them. So they have a very good view of what's happening on the internet at any point in time. And they came to the realization that being a DNS server wasn't their real business. Their real business was to see all of these transactions that they could see because of who they are and figure out who's doing something nefarious. If all of a sudden one IP address is trying to address all of these domain names, or vice versa, somebody's doing something bad. And so if you use OpenDNS, they don't let that through. They see somebody being nefarious, that IP address can't get to you. If they see your servers, your machines trying to get out to a specific domain name or IP address, they don't let that happen if it's listed in your website. So that was the bigger part of their business. And they were the guys that eventually stopped WannaCry. They redirected all the WannaCry requests through the OpenDNS, and they stopped it. They also collected a lot of information on what IP addresses were doing it. But it was so successful that it doesn't exist anymore. Because Cisco, somebody big always eats the little guys, right, bought them. And so all the WannaCry guys now, the OpenDNS guys are rich. And Cisco has a product called Cisco Umbrella that basically provides that service. You can buy that for your company. Cisco Umbrella is something they want to write down. That stops things from even getting in. But at the edge of your network, when you connect to the internet, you have a, basically a router. A router is a device that connects one network to another. Okay? In your case, it's probably not really just a router, it's a gateway, which connects an internal network to the internet. Okay? It's a form of a router. And it's probably not just a gateway either, it's probably a firewall, which has got stuff built into it to kind of try and prevent bad things from getting through into your network. Okay? They use things like network address translation so that your IP address is inside, never get to the outside, and vice versa, nobody knows either IP address. They use stateful packet inspection to see if packets coming through, packets of data are malformed and might have malicious stuff in. And recently, some companies have started to add an entire security monitoring service to your firewall. The firewalls we use are sonic walls. Given the environment we're in, smaller businesses, they're very cost effective and they perform well. And Sonic Wall is now running a SOC. A SOC is a security operations center. And there's probably a few commercials on TV where you'll see the a whole bunch of people. It looks like a NASA, you know, launch center, right? Big TV screens in front with data flashing through and maps and arrows and things and people at computers. And what they're doing is watching for threats and unusual traffic and that type of thing. And they've added that into your firewall now. So they sit there and as a service, they'll look at threats that are coming through and change that real time in your firewall so that you're not just subject to that. It's the kind of thing that a Fortune 100 company can afford and has to have. You can't. But you can by just buying a sonic wall and signing up for the service. It also requires that the hardware be changed kind of frequently because sometimes they need hardware features in the firewall to be able to implement some of the things. So they don't sell you a firewall outright. They rent it to you, and if something needs to be changed, you get a new one. Similar service from Barracuda Networks, if you want an alternative thing to buy. We feel Sonic Wall is the premier. They were in danger 2 years ago because Dell bought them. And anything that Dell buys usually goes poof. So it went poof, and Sonic Wall, the guys bought it back, and now they're running it again, and it works well. And then the last thing I'll say about protecting your network at the fringe is VPNs. And Alvin talked a little bit about VPNs. One of the big things that gives you advantages in your small business is the ability to remote into your network from home. You go home at the end of the day, have dinner, something hits your mind, you're like, oh, I want to go into my work machine. And that's a great feature, and a lot of people love that. But it creates the exposure that somebody can get into your machine from outside. And Microsoft hasn't done the best job, that's probably saying of securing RDP, Remote Desktop Protocol, getting into it. For some very simple reasons why they don't fix it, I'll talk more about that later. But so anyway, when you want to get into your work machine from home, you really need to do it through VPN. VPN is a virtual private network. You still connect to the internet connection to your office, but it does it over a private set of routes that and encryption that other people can't see it. So it's, you're using a public network like the internet to create as if you had a direct wire from your home to your office.
VPN is managed by Microsoft. You just disparaged Microsoft a minute ago, and now you're saying
and I will
VPN
continue
is a good
to
way
that.
So are you saying gay VPN or fooey VPN?
VPNs are created by the company to allow their employees to connect to them.
Yeah.
Microsoft doesn't manage it.
Okay, thank you.
Microsoft has some software that will allow you to establish a VPN, if you use it or not. I think it's probably secure. But also these devices, but typically your router would would be one end of a VPN, and you would have software in your home PC or your laptop which would create the VPN.
Yeah, will the SonicWall routers allow two offices to have a permanent VPN or WAN between
them?
Yes.
The other way you can create a VPN is a tunnel, where you have two hardware devices in a fixed place. They establish a VPN through each other, and it's there all the time. It's not something you start up when you log in from home or something like that. And any firewall worth its salt can create VPNs. It's a matter of how many can they create and what kind of performance can you get through it. Sonic Walls do it quite well.
I'm a country gal. I'm not in Armstrong territory, and they're my one and only choice. Do I have any control over that environment at all?
Sure.
Thank you. So I need to know.
You create a VPN over Armstrong, and you've got a VPN.
Gotcha.
It may not always be up.
You can make it persistent, so it will reconnect when the network comes back.
Yeah, good point.
Yeah, they take a lot of maps.
Okay. James?
Might be an indication of something else happening.
All right, access control. Now we get into the subject of passwords. When you talk about hacking in China and Russia and high tech and everything, that ain't really the way it happens most of the time. Most of the time, you let people into your network. And it's not a complicated thing. The social hacking, social engineering of hacking, is the most common thing that happens. Hillary Clinton's presidential campaign was hacked. Oh my God, the Russians must have hacked it, because who ordinary? And there was a fellow by name, I think it was Podesta. Is that her campaign manager? What's his first name?
John.
Okay, so let's say Jay Podesta is the user ID. Pretty common to use your first initial and last name. What do you think his password was? Anybody know?
Password?
Password.
Hillary.
Exactly.
Hillary.
So here we are, not a Russian in a room, and we just hacked into campaign. One time, one try, boom, we're in.
Not rocket science.
It's not. Equifax, something that we are all probably yet to feel the effects of, as people we don't know take out loans in our name, because they have all the information we need. Equifax was hacked. They have a series of mirrored servers around the world, because they're big and they're constantly replying to requests and stuff. And they had one in Australia, SQL server. And the typical user ID for, the default user ID for any server from Microsoft is admin, A-D-M-I-N, pretty common. What do you think the password was?
Password?
No, we used that one already.
Admin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Admin was the user ID.
Admin
was the password.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep.
Not unusual for people to do that. Oh, I'll be cool. I will use my user ID as my password. Nobody will figure that out. So it's not big, hard stuff. A lot of people are getting in some ways. And of course, there was a huge breach in that their website allowed access to their SQL server, which shouldn't have happened because they didn't keep it up. But once you got to the web server, it was easy to figure out. But one of the, your passwords should be changed. Okay? Shouldn't be using the default password that you got from the router. And it shouldn't be trivial. If your password is a word that's in the English language dictionary, they're going to get in pretty easily. It really, they talk about being used special characters and so many caps and all. Really, the important thing is that it's a word or a phrase that nobody else is going to easily figure out. Keeping in mind that people have your LinkedIn ID, find you on LinkedIn, And you mentioned, you know, you have grandchildren, and that's their name, and then they go to Facebook and they find your grandchildren. You know, they're going to know your dog's name, they're going to know everybody's birthday. So you may not be the best thing to use that stuff as your tricky password that nobody can possibly figure out. And the other thing is, and I don't have it on here because we're just starting up with it, but you probably heard about dark web searches. People do manage to get through your security and find your user ID and password and maybe some data about you. They collect that and they sell it on what's called the dark web, in files of people's. So it's important to know, is your user ID and password out there? And there's services now where you can get that from the dark web. I don't want to go into the dark web. It's a thing that government helped create. They use Tor servers, and it's totally anonymous, and the criminals now use it because it's totally anonymous, and nobody can find it. And we can't stop using it because it's how we built our whole data network, the clandestine data network. So it's out there. But an important thing to do also is to enforce a server policy that doesn't allow unlimited number of attempts to log into your computer. Now, this isn't a product. This isn't something you buy. This is something your computer guy has got to apply to your server. Okay? But you don't want to let people constantly try to access your user ID and password, just be able to try your password and run. Some companies lock you out at three retries. That's pretty frustrating, because I don't know about you, but I probably have 200 passwords for different things. And I'm getting old, I can't really remember them all. But we do 10 for our clients. At that point, really nobody's going to just get one of these power robot-driven things going. But you need something to limit it. And that includes the remote. Not only when you get on locally, but remote. And One of the exposures in Microsoft's RDP is they didn't provide a way to limit the number of retries to get in through to the RDP. Why, I don't know. They knew this stuff, but they didn't do it. Now, there are some third-party products that we use that limit that will do that. And then finally, if you've got data that's really critical and you really can't let anybody get it or the world's going to end, there's dual factor authentication or multi-faction authentication, meaning you don't just have a password. You have two things. You have something you know, password, and something you have. That could be your fingerprint. That could be a special dongle on a key or something you put into your computer. The approach that we use is we use a service that if we have critical data, that service will, and you log in, it will text you over your phone a code that lasts for like 10 seconds. And so you use your user ID password, boom, your phone rings, you get the 4-digit code, you put it in, and you're in. And that's pretty good. Yeah. And I think I covered most everything there. Under social engineering, I'll recover emails very well. Attachments to emails are what create problems. If you get an email with an attachment on it, be very wary of opening it. .txt files are probably benign. Anything else, worry about it.
Look at where it comes from.
But look at where it really comes from. Don't look at it, oh, this came from my boss. Look at the actual address it came from, because it may not be your boss at all. Okay, and that brings you to CEO stuff, where when you know your bookkeeper gets a message from you that says, "Please wire $15,000 to this account. We got to buy this stuff today. It's important. You know, the world's going to end if they don't get the money today." And your account, they're trying to do it, right? It happens. It's happening all the time. And since most of us have our company structure on our website or on LinkedIn somewhere or something like that, people know your structure, right? And they're going to be able to figure out who your bookkeeper is and who you are and send them an email. but it's not going to come from you. And if you look at the address, it's not going to be your address. So be aware of that. Make sure your people are aware of that. And probably the best thing is don't let anybody but you, if you're small enough, disperse funds. We got hit with this twice, and what saved us was my bookkeeper, my old bookkeeper, couldn't disperse the funds despite our best efforts, so we were safe from that. Phishing is when you give somebody else your user ID and password willingly. Okay? You'll get an email from your bank that says, we just want to confirm, you know, this $20,000 payment. And you go, what? I didn't make a $20,000 payment. And conveniently, they say, you know, to verify this on your account, click here to log in. And you click there to log in. But if you're aware, and you, as you mouse over that click here thing, you look into where that's going to, it ain't going to your bank at all. It's going to somewhere.ru or something like that. You know? And so you come up with a screen. The next screen looks just like your bank screen. And, oh, I can type my user ID and password in here, get into my account. No, you just gave them your user ID and passwords. And you realize that happened. You better get in there and change your user ID and password quick. There's very, very creative phishing campaigns out there. And I have to admit, I fell prey to it one time. And I spent the rest of that day changing my passwords everywhere. finally, in that subject, there's employee awareness is the only thing that can stop this. And there's companies out there, we haven't used Know before, and we're probably going to be changing that shortly. But there are companies that will provide your employees with training, video training over the net. Look out for these things. This is what all this stuff is. This is how they trick you. Don't let them trick you. Okay. And then they test you when you're done, so you know, you'll know all your employees listened and they understood. And then a week later, they'll send them a phishing email. Phony one, but a phishing email. Phishing email. And see what they do. And if they fall prey, that employee is notified that you've fallen prey to something they told you not to do. And they take them back through that section of the security training. And they let you know, too, if that happens. So, that's really the only thing that'll help you in that respect. If the employees are giving away your information, got to stop that.
Do you have any recommendations on the training companies?
Well, right now I'm saying we used Know Before, and they do a great job. The only reason why we're looking for somebody else is because all of these things I'm talking about, we usually get really good deals on, so we can package them up and offer them to our customers for really good prices. And Know Before isn't playing a game with us anymore. It didn't change the retail price, what you would pay if you sign up with them, but it sure changed our costs. They're not the only fish in the city.
Wombat is a local company that's nationally known for that. Wombat Technologies, they're local to Pittsburgh, but they're a big fish.
And if we can use a local firm as an owner of a local company, I say let's do it.
Pittsburgh connection.
What we got next, Jim?
There you go.
I probably talked about a lot of this stuff already. So. Kind of along the lines of keeping control of your network, when you set permissions in your server that everybody has to follow, you want to think about whether you want to give all your employees permission to install applications or not. In a small business, you got to be kind of flexible with this because you know, everybody wears a lot of different hats and they have to do a lot of different things. Big business, you can lock things down and say nobody in this department can install apps. Small business, it's tougher to do that, but think about that. You may or may not want to let them do that. Keep in mind that, still talking about installing apps, free is never free. Nobody's going to sit there and write a program so you can install it and do something. They're going to write a program so you can install it and they get something back at it. That could be the permission to, when you run your program, they may pop up an ad. They're selling ads. That could be they're distributing malware that's collecting data on your machine for marketing purposes to sell to somebody else. Don't know what all the reasons might be, but free is never free. Keep that in mind. And then who gets to access your applications? Something else you want your server guy to make sure that your permissions are set. You probably don't want anybody in HR being able to get into your accounting program, or vice versa, that kind of thing. And you probably don't want to let them have access to the files related to that part of the business. If you can group your people into different categories of functions, and then set up your files so that they only get to see the things. It's kind of like the old need to know thing, right? I mean, if you don't have a need to know, don't let them in. Jim. Now, Albert mentioned the best thing to do is not let anybody virus get into your machine, which is absolutely the truth, but sometimes that happens. And so I think you do need to be able to find those things and delete them if, in fact, they got through your other layers of security. The big guilty party here is a thing called interoperability, which started 30 years ago, which is where one computer could actually install and start a program on another computer without you intervening. That's a great feature for usability of computer systems and things you can do with computer systems, but it's what allows this to happen. Because if a little piece of code somehow gets into your system, it could be a virus that's designed to spread itself through all the machines in there. And viruses are usually very malicious. They're just designed to really hurt, do bad things, sick people create them. Malware is a little different in that it's usually a program that's designed to collect information about what you're doing and pass it on to somebody who's interested in it, typically marketing intelligence type of stuff. Windows has got Defender. It comes with your Windows program. That's had various degrees of success and failure as we've gone along. It's there. We used to use a product called Avast, which is actually free for home use, very inexpensive for non-home use, for business use. And it works quite well, and it doesn't interfere too much with the operation of the machine. There's malware bytes, and they're both virus things. Malware bytes does a great job on malware and can find some viruses too. It's free to download and use, but you have to pay a small fee for the pro version, which runs all the time and is monitoring things coming in. And then finally, the one we use is Webroot. Now, why do we use Webroot? We use it because of zero-day attacks. The way these guys do this, the way this happens, is a virus gets put out there. Somebody finds it. Here's a virus. And then there's organizations of virus programming companies that banded together to share this information amongst themselves. Find the virus. Okay, now we know it's out there. Virus came out here. We found it. Okay. This is how we can defend against it. This is what it looks like if it's in your machine. So we send, that's called a signature, virus signature. They send that out to all of their customers who use their virus software. And now your machine knows, hey, if this comes in, it looks like a virus. In a lot of cases, it takes a week for that to happen. Microsoft sends out updates once a week on things that they screwed up in the first place. Sorry, so they do. So a zero-day attack is really, you got the virus before your software knew that was a virus. That doesn't happen with Webroot, because Webroot's real-time. As soon as they find it, it's available to your Webroot software to protect your machine. That's why we use it. And ransomware. Now, Albert mentioned ransomware. This is the 500-pound gorilla in the room, where you got an email with an attachment that you thought was your picture of your girlfriend or something, and you clicked on it, and it's ransomware. And what it does is it starts encrypting the data on your hard drives with a key that they have. The key is a series of characters that is used to encrypt and de-encrypt the data. And the way you find out that happens is all of a sudden you can't get the files. Things are not accessible anymore. And that keeps happening until you somehow turn everything off or something. But you're, at that stage, you're done, okay? From what I'm told, Albert, you can tell me if this is true or not, you call the FBI about a ransomware attack, and they tell you, better pay it, because nothing we can do to help you.
Unless it meets a level of $5,000 or more for a loss, the FBI doesn't want to take that risk, because there's a threshold of, you know, how much can you actually research? $400, they're going to say, pay the fine.
Right. So you can either call the FBI.
We know of a case where a CFO took $40,000 in cash into a bad neighborhood, into a local drinking establishment, and there was an exchange made from a ransomware incident.
Yeah, and so what do? You pay it? I mean, you already know the people who did this are not above board people. So do you pay them and hope they decrypt it? Or if you pay them and they say, this guy will pay anything, and they ask you for more, I have a solution to that. It's on a later slide that I'll get to. This is the later slide that I'll get to. Business continuity or disaster recovery. The only practical way around a ransomware attack is to recreate your server as it was before the attack happened. That used to be very difficult in the past. You all know about backup, right? Everybody should back up their computer. All right, backup usually happens to maybe an external USB drive or something like that. Well, if you have a drive that's attached to your computer and a backup program can get to it, it's going to be encrypted too. So there's this concept called air gap. You've got to have a backup copy that's not connected to your system in any way. Then you survive the ransomware attack, your data will survive. You also have to make sure that, let's say your air gap is online backup, where your backup is up in a data center by somebody who provides it for you. And on your computer, you've got the application that lets you control that backup. I can tell it when to back up, how often to back up. Well, if they hack your computer and they get control of it, they can go to that application, the control panel, and delete your backups. Okay? So, it's best if the control of that is on somebody else's computer that's not involved. The amount of time they recover is another thing to think about. As hard drives get bigger and bigger, 500 gigabytes, terabytes, 2 terabytes, 3 terabytes, and you're gathering all this data, copying that back takes a long time. I mean, it takes days, literally. And that's if it's connected right to your computer. If it's over the internet, it can take weeks to get that. They're probably going to have to send you a hard drive of your data, so it can then take days to copy it. So the traditional backup thing is kind of losing some of its value to it.
It's an external drive that's not connected.
You'd be okay. If you remember to disconnect it after the backup's done. And if you take it somewhere else. Because the other thing that's a problem with local backups is if a disaster occurs, a flood, a fire, sprinkler system going on, and your backup is in your office, it's gone too. So, it's not real disaster recovery. Now, today's silver bullet. There's a thing called virtualization. And I don't want to use terms without making sure you understand what the term means. Virtualization of servers has been around since I started, really. DEC started it with their CMS system. IBM had virtual machine, VM, sysoperative system. It's a thing where they came to the realization that a server, a physical server, which has the programs running, is just a box. And they can take the programs and data that are associated with that server application and put it in a partition for that machine. Then they can create another partition, where the partition just being like this amount of memory is reserved, this amount of disk space. And so you can build multiple servers inside of one physical server, and those are called virtual servers. And the file system that these virtual servers use is our image files. It's just one big file that represents all the data and programs that are inside that server. That gives us an opportunity, because those image files can be backed up. And literally, those image files can be rebooted on another server, another virtual server. So the ideal approach is you have what we call an appliance, which is really just another server, on your network that takes image copies of your server or servers frequently. Typically, it's every 15 minutes it updates. So you have a current image on a whole other machine that's just copying these images. And if something goes wrong with your server, that other one, we can boot that image on that other machine that we put it in. And your server's back on your network, and it's working. It takes about 10 minutes. Because we're not copying data, we're just booting up another instance of your server. And it works great. It's saved. We've had two or three situations where our clients succumbed to ransomware, and it was a 10-minute thing as opposed to a crisis. Works very well. Now we also, once a day, take a copy of that image and we update our copy of it up in the data center. So you also have a slightly older version up in the data center that can be booted on a server up there. So if the worst happens, I mean, if your building burns down to the ground, if you were in California last week and you were going on to the fires, we can boot your server up in a data center that wasn't available. And it's available on the internet. Change your IP address that you go into, your employees can get it. They can go home, they can sit at their kitchen table and connect to that server and be able to work. And in conjunction with voice over IP technologies, which is basically using the internet for phone calls, we can also change the configuration of your phone system to redirect calls coming in to their homes or their cell phones. So it used to be a huge project, expensive project for big companies to set up disaster recovery centers. So what if something happens to a data center? It's pretty easy to do nowadays. We can have your employees work from home just like they were in the office. We can have their phone ring just like they were in their office. And you're still in business, at least from the administrative and data side of your business. Your machine shop may need support, which we can't do anything with that. So we currently use a company called Datto for that. They are, I think, the premier company in that respect. They're doing a great job on it, and it will keep your data safe. All else fails, all those layers fail, and you get screwed up. We can recover your situation. Datto is. And they're subject to the same things we have. Now they have four data centers they replicate data across. So they have to hit all four. But if they hit Datto, you still have your local stuff.
Right.
And it's a complete air gap thing because there's no connection between your machine and the Datto machine. So it's really pretty bulletproof, at least as of today. Who knows about tomorrow?
Could you just please repeat what the BC and data recovery, the BC
business continuity and data recovery. Because business, the ability to continue your business quickly is very important also. Oh, you got a backup, you can recover your data, it's going to take 3 days. Or versus, give me 10 minutes remotely, I'll be able to get that going for you. So, is that my last slide? Okay, so that's what we do. That's what we do for our clients, and you can replicate that on your own if you want. Or, now I'm not allowed to make a sales pitch, but I'm going to make a sales pitch. If you see Jim or I at the end, we have made a product called Security Essentials. There's some brochures back there. If you want to talk to us offline, it's pretty inexpensive compared to how much is a typical loss?
Oh, the typical loss depends on the number of records. Could be 30,000, could be, well, what did Equifax lose?
$41 billion. $41 billion.
Did anybody sign up for the Equifax the data protections and identity protections? Right? We would trust them.
What are they going to protect? It's already out there. That's like buying fire insurance when your house is on fire.
And if the people did read the agreement that you clicked on, I agree. It says you can't sue Equifax for anything that happened.
They did remove that.
They changed that.
Oh, did they?
I still don't trust.
Question. An understanding. When you guys are in the cybersecurity business and coming in and looking at the system and so forth, do you also, I'm not clear on this, do you also look at all the processes? Because the way I always look at concerns in our office is, you know, the people's both business and private use of their cell phones, using the access at home, putting their passwords taped inside their drawers. Do you look at that whole process? Because a lot of that, like you said, is the people that are controlling the security, let alone just going into the computers themselves and seeing that the firewalls are there. But the processes are really, really important. Right. And do you guys do that, or do we have to hire two firms to do that? Somebody else comes in there and looks at the process?
When we take over a new client, and most of our clients are flat fee, they just pay us a flat fee and we do everything. Okay? When we take over a client on that basis, we do a complete security assessment, network assessment for them that includes security. It is operational things that it points out too. And it points out, and typically what you find is there's dozens of employees that don't work there anymore and their user ID and passwords are still active when it is to the server. You know, like somebody doesn't work for you anymore, you just fired him and you think he's pretty happy with you. Now he finds out that his user ID and password is still valid and now he's getting into the server. That happens constantly. So we go through all of that.
Yeah, I would say from working at a larger university, I mean, we get a lot of phishing. We have VPN networks so people can access outside. So some of the standard things they put into place, for instance, it is required we have to change our passwords every 6 weeks. We have tree temps. If you don't get it right, you're locked out. That's a standard practice now. So it's kind of those things and putting those in place, just learning, just, you know, and people get used to it. I mean, you just kind of get used to it, of things putting in, things that there's certain servers or websites that are, if you're using a company computer, you cannot access. So it's kind of putting policies and procedures in place.
issue that I think is somewhat in the background, it's not as clear sometimes, is, yeah, we bought our cybersecurity insurance, but do we have the necessary policies and procedures, and are we following those?
Well, the people
that go have an issue, and you go and say, okay, I have an issue, cybersecurity insurance company, pay me, and they're going to say,
that comes
you didn't
part
do this,
and parcel
do
with
this.
The risk and compliance audit. The BYOD, bring your own device to work issue, is a major concern. The higher level executives that feel like they're exempt from security audits and things of that nature, that's also a major concern. You know, they take their laptop home and they're surfing the web and they get on Google, Facebook, LinkedIn, or whatever, and then they come to work and they're infected. You know, what do you do? So those are parts of an audit that we'll perform and find out whether that form, fit, and function is part of your process to find out how risky is your environment and what can we do to fix that. Okay.
One quick question for Mr. Will. When you go in and do an audit for a company,
yes,
presuming that every company has a certain number of resources or dollar value that they can put in, are there certain areas? How do you find out where they should be putting their resources in to protect themselves?
I'm not sure I quite understand.
How do you find out
so
where a company should really be putting its resources if it has a fixed budget of some kind?
Okay, so we'll come up with...
You can't reveal proprietary stuff. I understand.
Where are their risks, okay? And these are not the droids you're looking for. But we'll look into your environment and find out. Your servers need patched. are you monitoring traffic on your network to see, is somebody trying to break in because they're doing a brute force attack, trying to use 100 passwords in a minute, okay? Because that's a brute force attack, trying to break that password from an employee that just left an hour ago, okay? Or maybe they've done research on Facebook and they see everybody who belongs to that organization. Now they can figure out user IDs, okay, and get involved in your organization internally. What are you doing to protect your environment is key number one. Having business continuity is a great plan as well, okay? It's not gonna be a one-stop and you're done kind of an environment. It's gonna be, let's get started, let's get down the road and figure out where your vulnerabilities are, your weaknesses in your environment, and make you more robust, secure, and resilient to attacks. And when you're there, then you're doing better.
That has to be a conversation. I mean, when you do these assessments, you have to sit down with the owner and review what you found, what you think should be done, and what the risk is if you don't. You know, we've actually had some people decide they weren't going to address risks that were massive risks. And we've actually had them sign documents and say, I understand, I've chosen not to do this, and this is the implication. You know? And I don't want to, I dread the day I have to sit across the table from a guy and tell him he's lost everything. It would be a terrible thing.
Well, bring your own device. You know, I can see the laptop issue is very obvious. Phone issues is something that's not discussed, I don't think, widely. As far as bringing your own device. What's your opinion on that?
So, again, I'll go back to my previous comment. There's no firewall on this, all right? And everybody thinks it's unhackable, which is not the case. People are rooting these phones all the time to add additional software. Where do those rootkits come from? Same country that builds these for us also has the designs on how to break into them and how to exploit them. Now you can put that on a website, in a picture, in a movie, somewhere where you're not gonna see it because you can't see the hack in the wire, all right? You're not looking for that, we are. That's why we're here to talk about it. Putting these devices on your corporate network is a mistake. Making it accessible to your corporate network after going through filters, firewalls, and maybe putting some resilience on these devices like a product called Good, which makes sure that it never gets changed and you are stuck with this technology, which makes it a business product rather than a personal use device. All right? Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does.
Perfect.
Great. So, everybody good?
Yep.
Turn it over to Brett.
Thank you. So everyone's probably scared enough now that Albert can have gone through. So my company deals with forensics and incident response mainly, so we're firefighters basically. So when everything else has gone wrong, we get called in to figure out how it happened and just shut it down and kind of get enough battery for it happened again. I'm gonna focus on kind of just a few key areas of kind of the larger threat landscape that Albert and Ken both covered. So phishing attacks that were mentioned earlier, the ransomware attacks that often follow phishing attacks, and just a couple of things you guys can do about that from a technical standpoint, from a training standpoint, just to give you some options there. So before we hit the next slide, who is paying attention to what Ken said earlier, and how many feel like you could at least identify what a phishing attack is, at least conceptually? Good, lots of hints. Okay, so next slide, if you don't mind. So Wombat, that company I mentioned earlier, they have clients all over the world. They did a survey and only 65% could actually answer what is phishing. That's scary to me, right? That's a third of people asked that question that could not even come up with an answer for what that was. So really, as Ken mentioned, it's trying to obtain sensitive information by tricking. It's most commonly done through email. It can be a text though, phone call into your office, it doesn't really matter, there's different names for it, phishing, but it's tricking you into giving up your credentials. That same survey that they did, found that 27% of the attacks, the phishing attacks, were followed by malware. So some form of malicious code designed to steal your information, to further their attacks. The ransomware, of course, is the big component of that. And if the text on these slides is a little bit too small, I think we're handing the slides out to you guys, so don't worry about trying to jot down numbers or anything like that. And 17% of those attacks had a compromised account. So not just the email aspect, but the computer itself was compromised. So the bad guys are actually on your computer as if they were sitting in front of it. In our experience, we usually find that phishing attacks lead to the compromise of your email. And if malware is involved in that attack, then it's also a computer. So there's kind of sometimes stages in terms of the level of access that we can give your system there. So just a little example here. I'm sure we've all seen the Nigerian prince asking for $5,000 and $50 million. Phishing attacks aren't that easy to spot anymore with the average user. They can look very real. They can lift the login pages that you would be expecting to log into. So I think Ken gave a shipping or a banking example where you get that email that says, you know, your shipment has been delivered or your shipment has been canceled from Amazon. Right? Click here to, you know, see what happened. And you click on the link, you go to the web page, it looks like Amazon's login page. Well, it's very simple these days for the bad guys to basically capture what the Amazon login page looks like and display that to you. When you type in your username and password to it, your username and password is going to their servers, not to the Amazon servers. And so, you know, we see that all every day. You know, this is an example of that. A DocuSign document click here to review the document. If you click on that link and it takes you out to the website, it cleverly tries to tell you it's DocuSign here. I know you can't read this because it's blurry, but if you look at that URL, that's not DocuSign. That's not Amazon, it's not your bank. You have to pay attention to where you're going. See where that address is actually taking you to. The smallest little spelling change, you know, two I's right in a row, people read right past that, they don't see that. So you really have to pay attention to where you're landing when you're, you know, going after those sites.
Sorry, that one is rampant right now.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely rampant.
This is from our office, so this is one that we got.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, I used an example that, you know, we saw come in, and I was laughing at it. Good luck, guys.
Is there any way that they, I mean, you're telling us to watch that URL address and so forth. Is there any way that they're trying to work around that now and make the URL address somehow
obscure or enough that it looks like DNS, it was good? They can attack your DNS and redirect your traffic to a different IP address. You know, Ken talked about DNS is the address book for all the websites and domain names. So there's another way to do this, but we have a tool, Spam Zapper, it goes and checks your links, all right, so that you have less of an opportunity to get phished.
Yeah, one of the trickier things that they do is they use two V's to make a W.
That's a good one. And
you can't tell. If you look at it, the way you read, you can't tell, but it's two V's instead of a W. And there are a number of instances like that that are really hard to catch.
It gets a little bit technical, but if you go into a site that should be secure, so your bank, Amazon, pretty much anything that you actually log into on a daily basis, it should have a secure icon up in the left-hand corner of your browser. And most modern browsers, so Google Chrome, Internet Explorer, etc., should actually be green. So a legitimate business is going to have that kind of seal of approval, so to speak, to prove that they are who they say they are. So just
like VeriSign, for instance?
Yes, exactly. So if you click on that little kind of green icon up where the address starts, that can help identify who that entity actually is. In my experience, the bad guys are usually, it's plain as day, right? If you just look at that URL, I would say 99% of the time, you can pick up on the fact that it's not the real site right away. They're just banking on the fact that you're going to see the pretty picture and put it in your credentials because everyone's in a hurry today. So once you're phished, you know, you fall for that initial mistake, what's next? Really, there's a lot of options for the bad guys. They can, you know, install malware, as I mentioned, so the ransomware aspect is a big one. Redirection of email or forwarders. So we see this a lot when businesses use Microsoft Office 365 or Google or any of the other cloud-based email providers. The the bad guys will get your credentials for your email account, log into the account for the website, and then they go into the settings and they set up rules in your email account to send and receive emails to another account. So that every email you receive gets sent off to some account that they control, every email that you send gets sent off to the account that they control. That way, even if you think, I probably should have done that, I'm gonna change my password right away. Well, guess what? That rule is still in place, so it's still sending the email.
Are you saying that's cloud-based?
Yeah.
Come on.
All the time. So, you know, there's a lot of different ways that, you know, the attackers will kind of continue their attack and build on it, furthering the phish by leveraging a legitimate account. What I mean by that is, you know, somebody in your office gets hacked, now that person in your office sends out a phishing email to your coworkers, everyone's gonna believe it then, right? It came from my coworker, all the little tips and tricks to figure out, hey, was that really my coworker? Well, it was, a legitimate account, but they were the ones that got phished, and so now the bad guys are just kind of building off of that. And of course, if they actually end up on your laptop, on your desktop computer, doing local reconnaissance, doing the scanning, the network mapping, like the Albert touched on, where they're figuring out what your entire network looks like from that one spot that they've ended on. Verizon puts out a yearly report on incident response. They're actually the largest incident response firm in the world. And they gather information from other firms, you know, like ours and others, that do that sort of work. Every year they publish really great details about what the attack landscape looks like. You know, their report from last year showed 95% of phishing attacks were followed by some sort of malware. If you remember earlier, the Wombat one was about 27%. It's probably the difference in the customer base and a lot of, you know, high-end corporate stuff on the Verizon report, most likely.
Where do you see these reports?
You can, if you just Google Verizon DBIR, make sure it's on Verizon's website, you'll find it. There's an executive version that's about 10 or 12 pages that kind of hits the highlights, and there's a technical one that's probably 40 or 50 pages that gets into the details, but they're a good one. Ransomware, you know, big problem, as Ken mentioned. 72% of all healthcare malware infections were ransomware. That's big time. HHS guidance is that a ransomware attack is considered a breach until you prove otherwise. That's tough, right? Because the assumption is there that the bad guys were on your system. Colin?
I have your question. In your estimation on these ransomware circumstances, what percentage of the time do they actually have the key that can open up your system if you do indeed pay them?
Great. I'd say it's still probably pretty high. You know, ransomware is a big business, like, you know, multi-billion dollar business. They have call centers, right? And I'm not kidding, like legitimate call centers, technical support to help you pay. It's a business of ours. So most of them do, they will unlock it. Now, the NotPetya attacks, Bad Rabbit that was out a few days ago, you know, typically hit more in the UK, Ukraine and in Europe. Those attacks, no. They were, some argue, were designed as a wiper attack. So the bad guys never actually had the key to unlock it if you wanted to. Your payment wouldn't even go through in those instances. You send money into no one, and nobody would actually get the money. It was just an attack to wipe out your systems. But most, I would say, do.
We've heard from clients that they're very customer service oriented. They
want to help you give them money. Of course they're customer service oriented.
A friend of mine that I talked about at the beginning who was mad at the credit card company, you know, it took her so long to get them to accept the payment. And then of course she had to turn around and tell them you were right. But he said, oh, he was such a nice young man, you know, and all this stuff. And then she said to me, he even reduced his price. When I, you know, she told me exactly, I'm an elderly lady, I don't have that much money, I can pay you X, and he said, okay, you know.
Take what they can get. There's been some stories, you know, that there might be a little bit of honor among thieves where we've heard of some businesses that have gotten hit, and then they got hit again by the same bad actors, and they actually gave them the keys to decrypt it, because they felt bad for them.
Did you ever encounter one of these circumstances where someone will get a phone call from perhaps Microsoft or Amazon or something of that ilk, and they will bilk the individual into turning over their computer on a WebEx type environment?
Oh, We see that quite a bit, actually. Often, you know, executive level people, you know, the less technical, fall for that a lot. And, you know, we investigate that quite a bit, because then it's not just a phishing or ransomware attack where it's malicious code running on your computer, it's actually somebody on your computer poking around.
Is that a wire fraud circumstance?
So not really wire fraud. I mean, it could lead to that, certainly. But in most cases, fortunately, actually, most cases that we've found is the bad guys do that as part of the scam to get the money out of you, and they actually install free antivirus scanners on your computer, they run antivirus scans, they change some settings, they make it look like they're doing legitimate technical work on your computer because you can see them. When they log in through those functions, you can actually see what they're doing. So they pretend to work for a half an hour, and then you send them the $400, and you know they might have left a back door there to come back later, but they at least pretend to get some work done. So something Ken touched on earlier, the backups, key to ransomware defense. Unfortunately, a survey Barclay organization, 42% of the victims were actually able to recover from the backups. So all of those, you know, kind of thought process, the planning that goes into what your backup strategy is, really is important. If your backup is accessible over the network, then that ransomware is just going to encrypt those backups. So you have to make sure that there's a mechanism in place that protects those backups. And you know, there's a lot of different technologies there that can do that. Other things that, of course, play into that are unmonitored and tested backups. So you have backups that you think are running. You set up that backup job, or your IT person did, you know, a year ago. And maybe you get a daily email that says that it ran, and nobody's ever tested it. Well, just because it ran doesn't mean that it's going to work to restore. So another kind of key area there. I mentioned the encryption issue, and then just the loss of data between the backup periods. So that backup mechanism is a slow link, and it takes too long to back it up. You might be days out in your critical data before you all ever get it restored because the backup process itself is taking wow, this
is an eye test.
That is an eye test. It certainly did not look that horrible here. So ransomware, just a couple different examples there. Lockheed was the major one a few years ago. You know, probably one of the best known ransomware attacks. It got distributed through Office macros. So if you go over and open up a Microsoft Word or Excel document, and it has a little button at the top asking you to click on it, that's enabling macros. That's a bad idea. So you know, you have to be careful about that. You know, that one particularly made the news because it locked a bunch of hospital systems out of the data. 2016, so hospitals had to declare a state of emergency and go back to paper records. You can imagine, you know, what that did for patients and the community. Server is a fun one, fun the geeks, I guess. It uses text-to-speech capability, so it actually read the ransom out loud over your speakers. So, you know, gone are the days that somebody in the cube gets a ransomware notice and they can just kind of like shut off the monitor or pretend it didn't happen because it actually reads out loud. Not pet, yeah, I mentioned this, you know, a wiper type attack where it pretends it's a ransomware, but you can't actually pay it even if you wanted to. It just encrypted all your systems and you're kind of stuck. If you don't have backups, you're out of luck on that one. There were some local companies that were hit by that, but again, it was mostly over in Europe and Ukraine. Started with a company over there. Next slide. So, just to walk through some of the phases of what a ransomware or other malware attacks looks like, is that initial infection, you know, from that phishing email or whatever mechanism that comes in. It starts a communication with what they call C2 servers. So it's kind of like the mind behind the ransomware, right? The bad guys are directly connecting to your computer to control ransomware or do those actions. It's a server that they maintain in the cloud. That then allows them to kind of have visibility over all of their attacks. Because it could have been targeted to you, or it could be a ransomware attack that is spread across the globe. And they have tens of thousands of customers just like you. And so they need a way to manage that. The C2 communication is how that happens. So it's communicating with that server to allow more malware, more attacks down in your system. The encryption phase, of course, this is where I think Albert mentioned there's technology out there that will look for the start of that encryption process and then block it. Because it's not normal activity of the computer system. To suddenly have all the files being opened and changed, that encryption can happen. So that's usually running in the background. You know, the user isn't aware of it until it's too late. The cleanup process, and by cleanup I don't mean the good cleanup, I mean the bad cleanup. The ransomware has evolved over time where now they're encrypting backups, they're deleting files, they're deleting log files that, you know, investigators like myself look at and try to figure out what happened. So it's doing an extra destruction phase beyond just the encryption. Again, kind of a backup process there. And then of course the ransom scare, the final piece of it all. Your desktop background changes, you get the audio message, whatever those visual cues are that your information has been encrypted, they need to let you know because they want you to pay. And you know, it's always followed by some sort of threat. You have a time limit, you know, 24 hours, 72 hours, whatever it may be. You're asking for some Bitcoin, for some anonymous payment, and make their cash. Another research article by Osterman Research. The text I'll let you read later. The takeaway there is the way in which ransomware is getting into the businesses. Email link that you're clicking on is 31%, the attachment is 28%. Right there, you're almost at 2/3 of ransomware attacks are coming through an email mechanism. So the more you can filter out the perimeters, the better your app, and then the training piece, which we'll get to, is kind of your next best defense there. Website-based attacks is another 24%, so that's, you know, high up there as well. I have some slides to kind of get into that, but that's, you know, you inadvertently, excuse me, visiting a malicious site, maybe you got tricked into it, or it could even be what they consider a drive-by dip attack, where you're on a legitimate site, but something else on that site is malicious.
Is that because they were attacked and didn't know it, most likely?
Sort of, yeah. I mean, I don't even know that I would consider it an attack necessarily, but that's what we're getting into right here, which is this concept of malvertising.
Yeah, but
it's malicious advertisement. So if you think about your visit out to CNN or whatever your favorite website is,
Facebook,
and the billions of ads that are on that thing, right? Those ads aren't controlled, maintained, monitored at all by CNN or where the website provider is that you're actually visiting. It's, you know, third party. A third party, it's not a great setup in terms of attribution of who's buying what and putting what ads on whose sites. So it's just a money maker. But what the bad guys have figured out that they can do is they basically rent time on a legitimate website and they provide a legitimate looking ad that if you click on it, that click causes the attack. And this chart kind of like walks you through that whole piece, but the scary part about it is you can be on a legitimate site and not know it. So the risks of your clicks, where you're going, what you're clicking on, what you're looking at is key there. And then having the different software tools that these gentlemen have mentioned to help try to block that. Malwarebytes, I'm actually a big fan of that as well. They have a component to their pro version that's called exploit blocker, I think. But it actually looks for those types of attacks at your browser level, and it helps block them. So just some ways to help mitigate ransomware type attacks. We'll get into the technical ones. There are a number of slides on those. Some of them I certainly wouldn't expect you to go back and do yourself, but you can call up, you know, any number of consultants here and get some help with that. And then the non-technical ones, you know, it's really about education and training people so that they see it every day, they know what it looks like, they know the changes that are coming, because the bad guys, they change their tactics. So we have to change our level of knowledge of all of our employees and ourselves to make sure we keep up with that. And one other thing that I didn't write in here anywhere, but I should mention, is nomoreransom.org, right down that website. I don't have it in the slides. It was a partnership between law enforcement and private entities that kind of banded together to help provide a free resource if you've ever been hit by ransomware. So there are a lot of strange ransomware out there that there are decryption tools for. They publish all of them in one spot. you can submit samples to them. So if you have a file that's encrypted, you can send it in and they can tell you what strain of ransomware hit you. So it's a really good free resource to check out.
Can you say that website again?
NoMoreRansom.org. So as you're calling up, you know, your insurance carrier or your attorney or your incident responder or whoever, you know, that's something that you can do by yourself to kind of start to get some information.
Who runs this?
It's a group that's part law enforcement, part private industry. So I'm not sure who the names are behind it, but I know, like, I think if Rivard is actually involved in the FBI, others. So you can go ahead and slide there. So some of the preventative technical measures, email and firewall filters that we've touched on, there are, you know, every day, you know, somebody's coming out with new attacks and the good guys have to come out with new ways to help combat it. So, you know, you might hear machine learning and, you know, AI being involved in products these days to help try to keep up with these evolving attacks. Palo Alto Networks, but I think SonicWall, others, they have some of these things built right into the firewall now. For all the, you know, kind of bashing that we might do of cloud, Microsoft Office 365 actually has a ton of great security features if you just enable them. A lot of times they're built into subscriptions actually that you already have and you just don't know it. Other times it's a cheap add-on, it's, you know, $2 a user a month or something like that. And it enables all those additional filtering capabilities to help, you know, keep the stuff on the periphery and not in your systems. So they work, a lot of these, by detonating or opening the files in what they call the sandbox environment or a virtual environment. So when that attachment comes into your email, they actually take that attachment, they open it in their virtual environment, and this is all done by machines, not people. They open it in the virtual environment, and the computer systems then monitor what happens. When I opened up that Microsoft Word document, did it try to call out to the internet? Did it try to download files? Did it try to do this? Did it try to do that? And so that protection is all kind of built in, again, at the outside edges of your network, so that if truths happen after all those tests or, you know, any of those tests, then they're able to say, hey, this thing's probably malicious, even if we don't have a known virus signature for it. So it's just kind of an advanced feature that we've built into some of your, you know, email-based tools. Web browser protections, I think I mentioned that earlier, you know, so that's kind of like the blocking of the anti-exploit type things. It's really keeping up with your security patches. So if you don't have somebody watching that for you, I would highly advise that. Flash, everyone's probably familiar with Flash. I view a lot of videos online. And Adobe Reader, unfortunately Adobe gets picked on a lot. Say why. What's that?
Flash is dying rapidly.
Yeah, well, so they say. It's supposed to be done by 2020. It can't happen soon enough. Actually, the Bad Rabbit ransomware attack that just happened a few days ago was a big Flash exploit. But it's an exploit a day, basically. So if you look up the numbers of how many exploits get released for that, it comes out to close to one a day for years. So it's horrendous. So you really have to keep up those patches. You know, continuous vulnerability assessments, I think Albert might have mentioned. You know, there are tools out there that you can put into your network that will continuously scan your systems looking for that. Because all of these, you know, little add-ins to your web browsers, it's hard to keep up with them, right? They don't always automatically update. They don't even have that feature built in. You have to remember to do that. And then, you know, if you don't, you're up on the chopping block for the bad guys to take a scan and realize that you're vulnerable. Microsoft might release their patches, you know, quite frequently. It's easy to keep that up to date. But all the extra little add-ons are the ones that are tough that you have to keep an eye on. And so that continuous scanning is a big help in that. And for an antivirus, and I use antivirus kind of generically there, so you know, you'll hear things like next-gen endpoint protection and all the fancy marketing names. At the end of the day, they're all working in very similar fashion in that the bad thing has to happen first, and then the good guys figure out what the signature is to that bad thing, they distribute it and they block it. You know, there are some heuristic type technologies that are built into some of the agents where they're looking at kind of patterns of activity, not so much the bad code itself, and that helps block it kind of ahead of the curve a little bit. But that's a key thing to make sure that all your systems, your laptops, your desktops, your servers, have one of those products on them to help try to block it if it gets in through the perimeter. You know, blocking executables running from temporary directories, so this is a little bit of a technical thing where you might need, if you don't have an in-house IT admin, you'll have to probably get help from outside to do this. But if you think about the way that ransomware and other malware attacks happen, is they're coming in through email and they're coming in through your web browsers. So when you click on those things on your computer, it's actually opening up those files in a temporary directory within a certain kind of section of your computer's account. And if you block programs from running from those areas, then the malware can't start, can't be launched. And most legitimate programs never need to run from there. If you install your accounting application, Microsoft Word, whatever applications that you use every day, they're running from the program files directory or other known expected locations on your computer. Malware doesn't. It launches from these obscure places. And so you can make changes to your system to help block that, so that even if you did click on the wrong document, the actual execution, the actual encryption would never start. But if you get into the weeds there in terms of the technical implementation there a little bit. So definitely, you know, ask for help if you're looking for that. I mentioned disable Microsoft Office macros. I think that's done by default now in Office on the newer versions. So you have to purposefully re-enable them. So unless you have a spreadsheet that, you know, somebody built macros into it for you for a business purpose, then there's no need to ever have macros enabled. It's a huge, you know, way in for the bad guys to execute malicious codes. So it's a big trick that they play on people. So you're even seeing it right in the email message, you know, this document requires you to do X, Y, Z and do that, and they give you the instructions. I mentioned this already in terms of blocking the executables. This is just some of the details about where that is and the concept of whitelisting. So there are tools. You can buy third-party products that do that. We don't actually sell them ourselves. I don't know if these gentlemen do, but you can ask about it. And the functionality is built into Microsoft Windows. It's just a little complex to configure. But the concept there is you know what your legitimate applications are, and you whitelist them. And everything that's not on that list gets blocked. Now that can become a little bit of an administrative headache if you make a lot of changes. So if you use QuickBooks for, you know, your number crunching and a new version of QuickBooks comes out, you have to remember to disable that rule to update QuickBooks and then re-enable it. Because even updates to your legitimate applications won't happen because it's that detailed. It knows this exact version of this file is the only thing that's allowed to run, and anything outside of that is blocked. It's great for preventing attacks, but you really have to get into the weeds of understanding what's running on your systems. Is this really what I want, right? And so that exercise and audit maybe might help identify that. You might have applications that your employees are using that they really have no need to be using in the first place. And it might be a, you know, kind of a threat to your system. You can go ahead. Just some general information security best practices. So the concept of least privilege, I think we touched on this a little bit earlier. So that's the idea of only having access to what you need to get your job done. It's removing administrative access from your computer unless you absolutely have to have it. And if you do have to have it, you have a separate account to do it. So if you log into your computer every day and if you can just click launch or run or install and you can install a program, that's a problem because you're not running as a standard.
Going on that notion of having another account, how many people in the room log in and have administrator access on their PCs?
Or don't have?
Stop doing that. That's if you have administrative access and you download malware, it has the authority to go change your computer. Log in as a normal user, make changes when you have to. Set up a separate administrator. And don't call it administrator.
Yeah, there's that trick too. So that's a key piece.
Simple things can help you a long way down the road.
Yeah. That's actually, so the concept of least privilege or access control like that is I think, the number two mitigation strategy by the NSA for cybersecurity. Application whitelisting is number one. So these are pros. They know what they're doing. You know, they're on that list for a reason. And they are simple changes. They are. The backups, I already kind of hit on this, so we can skip through this. That's just really remembering that if your backups are online and you can reach them without, you know, providing any separate credentials or anything, then so can the network. So training, we mentioned this. There's a couple URLs, I know you can't read them here, but this is just kind of pre-based training from Cornell University in Berkeley for kind of the awareness training, which is proficient. I also mentioned Wombat, local company, nationally known. They actually have international customers, I believe. They're great at doing that same sort of thing, where they'll actually provide you a website that you log into, and it trains you on what phishing emails look like and how to respond, and not just phishing emails, all sorts of different online threats. But education is a huge component of, you know, reducing that likelihood of a bad attack actually being successful. Unfortunately, sometimes humans are the biggest link in the security chain. Good. The next one. So just some generic tips to avoid phishing things. So obviously, you know, I say obviously, but not sometimes it's not always so obvious. Never respond to emails that request personal information. Always be suspicious of sensitive information requests. Be cautious about opening up attachments. I mentioned the Office macro piece. You know, downloading files, no matter who you think they're coming from, you really have to make sure you know who it's coming from. And when in doubt, call the sender. I can't tell you how many times you've had to investigate a case because the CEO or some high-ranking individual said, do X, and somebody responds to the email and says, am I really supposed to do this? Well, what do you think the attacker's going to say? I've actually seen arguments.
Isn't it done yet?
Yeah, I've actually seen arguments between the attacker pretending to be a CEO, IT security staff, and the person who was phished, saying, do this, IT saying no, the CEO saying yes, I'm, you know, demanding that you do it. It's sort of hilarious, but it's sad too. Pick up the phone. Right? Contact them through some alley bad means. I already mentioned, check the website that you're visiting is secure. You know, is that really Amazon? Is it really my bank? Look at that green little lock icon in the top corner. Open it up, it will tell you if it is in fact the right business.
What is the credibility of Snopes?
S N
O P E S. Snopes.
So it's on the internet, anybody can contribute to it. What do you think the credibility is? I'm just saying.
Just saying. And then of course I've mentioned kind of the misspelling of names and domains. You know, poor grammar, all those things are just indications that, you know, it isn't as it seems. Next one. So the last slide, I believe. So if you are using cloud-based email, Office 365 and Google are the most popular ones, of course. If you use Office 365, write down that address. It's secure-score.office.com. Have your IT admin go there. If you don't have one, whoever set it up for you, make sure they know about it. Microsoft built a ton of functionality into that website that's part of your Office 365 account, and it walks you through things that you can do to help secure your account. One of those things is multi-factor authentication, I think that Ken mentioned. It's built into Office 365. If you pay for Office 365, you probably already have it. You should be using it because it'll stop a phishing attack. Some other things, they're building reports, again, with Office 365, they have tons of logging capability in there that you probably don't know about. Again, if you have an IT admin, they definitely need to be reviewing that stuff. It'll flag logins from unknown places, repeated failed logins, and then a successful login, which is a key indicator that somebody broke in. All of those little tips and tricks that Microsoft tracks for you are there and available for you. You just have to pay attention to it. Google has similar features, not quite as robust as Office 365 from what I've found. They do offer two-step verification. They even do that on the free accounts. They have some built-in security and auditing reports, but not nearly the amount that Microsoft does. And then they actually just rolled out a week or two ago what they're calling their Advanced Protection Program. It's really geared towards like journalists and people who are like high-value targets, so to speak, where the multi-factor authentication into that Google account requires a physical. So they'll actually help you set that up. It's part of their building functionality. It's available to you. systems. I think that's it. The last one. Yep. So, I think that's it. So, any questions, certainly come up, ask any of us.
Thanks, Albert and Ken and Brett. I got three things, main things out there. So one is being proactive and almost making this part of your normal business cycle of reviewing your, you know, your IT systems, talking to your IT consultants and all that. The other one is backups. That's the thing that, you know, jumped out at me a lot. And the last thing is make a paper copy of everything. you guys have any last comments or good to go?
Nope. I just Jim Humphreys is my business manager. He consolidated all these slides together. Thank you for doing that for us this morning, Jim. And he also created that brochure in the back that he'll be very upset if you don't take it.
I'll have another
one.
Can
you give us your business card? We'll email you the pitch. Make sure you have a copy of it. And put you on our newsletter because I know you want that.
I just wanted to point out that in your folders, there's a handout that the SBDC Network across Pennsylvania has put together in conjunction with Delaware SBDCs. So take a look at that. I'd love you to fill out these surveys. I mean, it would be a very, I think after hearing the experts today, you've got some real good information on what you're doing and not doing right now. But the survey kind of takes you through that. We'd love you to do that. Like I said, you have to fill out the request for consulting. I'd love you to stay right now and do it, but if you really would like to do it and you're in a rush, you can mail it in to us. We would appreciate that. And also, we are very thankful to SMC for having us here today. And we've got Denise McCune, who's just going to say a couple words about SMC.
Well, thank you. I'm going to make y'all turn this way. That'll like make you move a little bit. So I won't keep you long because I see everybody's like got a foot out the door. I just want to, first of all, welcome you on behalf of SMC. We are a business association. Any members in here? Hey, great. Well, hopefully you have great things to say about us. I'm the human resource director here, and it is one of the services that we offer our small businesses. I get phone calls all the time. In fact, I was on for an hour this morning with an organization who was having an employee problem, and clearly I set the world straight. So in addition to human resources, we have an insurance agency. We have a very strong, active, and viable government lobbyist who is just a shark in terms of working with legislators and small businesses. She has many committees, and they are a very strong voice locally and in Harrisburg. So those are probably the three strong pillars in addition to our community and networking activities. We have signature events that we do that give you an opportunity to come together as members and interface with one another. And we have our conference room and offices that are of use for our SMC. But mostly, besides the wonderful things we do, we're a great group that enjoy working with our members. So welcome. I know it's been a great opportunity. Two of us were out there going, oh my gosh, we forgot it was the Cyber, so we so wanted to listen in. So we're going to steal some of your literature. And I probably violate everything you've ever said here this morning. So, thank you all for being here. Thank you to Mary and Ann. Always good to see you. Thank you. Have a great day.
And our next big program you might have an interest in is November 8th. It's the sales boot camp. So if you want to find out more about how you can sell your products better, we've got a great speaker for that.
One last thing I want to leave you with. Every second you delay on security makes you closer to one hack away.
And I'm just really impressed with that speaker. Let's just give him another round of applause.
The slide deck, please let me know.
Christine has given them to everybody. So we're covered, but see, we'll get more.
I did used to work just HP maintenance. It was going through my mind.
If you could just leave it.
Really don't be scared. We're here. Who are you gonna call?
Yeah, it was good seeing you.
Same here.
Come to some of our other stuff.
And you have to.
Yeah, I do. I do. I'm good.
Seth, how are you?
You too. What is this?
Yes.
Probably weighs a little bit. I think probably
It's a 7-month course that SBA offers.
I did. Well, actually, it was a lottery of course. There's certain criteria that they have to arrive in.
But I like it.
hundreds.
Well, it's education, you know, training.
Yeah, do you have a good one?
Really could be.
That's not a part of it, once you get back to your office.
I was gonna go meet with someone in the office as well. Where the rest of your, where the rest of your, where the rest of your.
I don't mind.
It's rough, everybody's for sure. Probably doing our website with the vendor. We have to go fill out a questionnaire.
I do.
That's why I wanna make sure I have time, so I said not quite one, let's do 1 or 5.
Oh, okay.
Round it, Jason.
That's great.
Yeah, I had a whole team that proposed on the most like. There were some comments.
Wish I said.
Redo the.
Oh, the whole. You know, and I thought of her as more accessible. I went on to her website and watched, she's only 45, so she didn't meet that.
She was just started.
Right.
They did it a couple years ago.
And I don't know. That's like the all-score on the board thing.
That's why we thought of you, maybe you'd have.
When you get into these monstrous.
And when a lot of people are age.
A little bit at a time.
That's where, you know what I mean, like on the brink of that, so.
If you're not doing the time right, then. Send those out, I don't have any programs like that. We encourage her, because we were with her, but if you're safe, we wanted to start. Because you know what, some of the speakers we had, this room, we don't have any in town. She was scary sometimes, but. She did stitch up the embroidery.
They want more data.
And Janet actually tried calling her.
I'm not gonna worry, but I mean, I feel bad when you can't get a referral, because then the next time maybe.
They're retired, people don't realize that.
Nobody at work knew.
Well, you know, that's what I started to go through.
Another
million on the wireless. You know, took advantage of research.
And when our generation.
I went through all this stuff with being here for the rest of my life. Yeah, right. I thought a friend died. He's been in business.
I'm not gonna worry, but I'll just go back and say sorry, we can't help you. Maybe you need to call the innovation.
Interesting, was it, you liked it?
Those are young, those are usually young. Nobody, so you're just gonna go, wow, hopefully you're not insulting them. Totally go, I'm 38.
That's what I was gonna say, like, oh,
sorry. Thank you for coming, that's really good.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.